Great. So welcome everyone. This is Nicola Marzari that will be chairing this 20th distinguished lecture. I think we live at strange and difficult times. Usually the distinguished lecture is held here live in Lausanne at TPFL. It's a wonderful event. But of course, in these COVID times, we try out new ways. And you know, what is a challenge becomes also an opportunity. That means that people that wouldn't have been able to travel to Lausanne can nevertheless attend remotely to this. And so it gives me, you know, a really great and personal pleasure to introduce today's speaker, Professor Stefano Baroni. He is a professor of theoretical condensed matter physics at the Scuola Internazionale Superiore di Studi Avanzati, that is SISSA in Trieste, that has given, I think, so much to the world of electronic structure, condensed matter physics, and also materials simulations. I think that Stefano's science doesn't really need an introduction, but I think it's a pleasure to actually mention some of the accomplishments that really have guided our fields. I would say, you know, maybe picking up the introduction of density functional perturbation theory that nowadays is widely used to calculate the response properties of condensed systems, you know, starting from such fundamental quantities as phonons, third order derivatives, and in some ways also giving rise to theories of thermal and electrical conductivity. But Stefan has also worked on many other things. You know, just speaking from memory, I remember when I started actually working with him, you know, personal note, you know, work on linear n, order n scaling methods that were very exciting new developments, quantum Monte Carlo methods. Of course, extending also ideas from linear response theory to the domain of time-dependent density functional theory, to look at excited states. Many of these methods and theories are actually extremely relevant to predict from first principle computational spectroscopic coefficients. There is also, I think, a very nice link with TPFL. Stefano, after his laurea in physics at the University of Pisa with Giuseppe Pastori, moved here to Lausanne to the Institute of Physique Théorique under the direction of Professor Antonio Quantropani. At the time where the Institute was actually in the center of Lausanne in Avenue de l'Église Anglaise, and then moved back to Trieste in 1984, where it's been ever since with many visits to universities worldwide. So with this, I think we'll hear some, I think, very novel and very exciting arguments and topics today in his talk on gauge invariance of heat and transport coefficients. So with this, Stefano, really an honor and a pleasure, as they say.
Thank you very much, Nicola. I owe a special thank to Nicola for having me with you today and to all of you to be with me today. So as Nicola was saying, this is actually an opportunity, something that personally I'm not very used to. It's just this new COVID times that have started the habit of giving webinars. And I'm flattered by the large attendance. And just going through the names, many of whom I know, I would like just to mention the two or three whom I wouldn't have met otherwise, and whom it is a pleasure to say hello to. Antonio Quattropani first was mentioned by Nicola. Buongiorno Antonio, very pleased to me to be with you today. Jorge Soffo from Pennsylvania, Hi, Jorge, and August Gulseren, and many other whom I don't remember. I saw in the list. So let me cut the introductory part short, and let me start. Let me try to start the presentation. So today I will report on my last scientific passion that started a few years back, maybe 5-6 years back. I got interested in transport properties, which was very new to me at those time, and motivated mainly by the belief that was widespread at the time that heat transport coefficients could not be computed from density functional theory. I am a DFT man, and I've been a DFT man for all of my life. And I found it unacceptable that a theory that was very successful in predicting many ground state properties of many different materials was supposed not to be able to compute thermal conductivities. And so I started with some very gifted students of mine, started thinking hard on how to change that state of affair. And today's lecture will be a report of the fun that my collaborators and I have had all over these past 5-6 years in delving into the theory of adiabatic heat and charge transport in materials. So basically, in this talk, I will try to give serious answers, supposedly serious answers to two silly questions. The first one is, how is it that the heat conductivity is well defined? It can be measured, so it is certainly well defined, when the energy current that determines it is not. And second, and related to this, a seemingly distinct question, but which has a common answer, is how is it that the electric conductivity of non-charged molecular fluids vanishes? Pure water without dissolved salts is an insulator, is an electric insulator. However, microscopically, the current fluctuations from which the conductivity can be computed do not vanish. So how is it that a non-vanishing conductivity can arise from vanishing current fluctuations? In order to answer these two questions, let me start by some very general concepts. The theory of transport is basically the theory of the low energy behavior, the low frequency behavior of conserved quantities, such as energy, charge, and mass. So in a macroscopic body, any conserved quantity, be it energy, charge, or mass, flows from regions of high density to regions of low density so as to maximize the entropy. The resulting current that is needed to equalize the density throughout the system is going to be proportional to the gradient of the thermodynamical quantity of the intensive quantity conjugate to the conserved quantity being transported. To be specific, when one speaks of heat transport, the thermodynamic heat transport is the transport of energy, and the intensive quantity conjugated to the conserved quantity being transported is the inverse temperature, and the current is proportional to the gradient of the temperature, the proportionality coefficient being the heat conductivity. Likewise, when the conserved quantity being transported is charged, then the intensive variable conjugate to the charge is the ratio between the electrochemical potential and the temperature, and the current would be the product of the electric conductivity, the charge conductivity, and the electric field. The green Kubo theory of linear response basically establishes a correspondence between the transport coefficient and the microscopic fluctuations of the conserved quantity at equilibrium. So one has that if you compute time correlation function of the heat or charge conductivity at large times, it will go to zero. At short time, it will basically be the magnitude of the equilibrium value of the current, and the integral of this correlation function for large times, according to Green and Kubo, this pillar of non-equilibrium statistical physics, this integral equals the thermal coefficient one is after. This it can easily be demonstrated using the argument that was introduced by Einstein in one of his famous papers of 1905, that this transport coefficient can be only evaluated and seen as the slope of the squared integral of the current divided by time. This is the same thing as the diffusion coefficient being equal to 1 over t, the integral of v of t prime dt prime square modulus, so that is the famous Einstein relation for the diffusion coefficient. Basically, the same algebra can be used to extend this relation to any transport coefficient. And we will see that this Einstein-Helfand expression for the transport coefficient that is totally equivalent to the Green Kubo formula is very handy to derive some of the key properties that we will be exploiting in the rest of my talk. Before moving on, let me just remark that this Green Kubo expression for the transport coefficient basically amounts to saying that the transport coefficient is the product of the square magnitude of the current at equilibrium times the autocorrelation time of the current, that is the time it takes for a current fluctuation to regress to zero, to regress to equilibrium. So the program now is clear. One has an expression of the transport coefficient in terms of the green cubo integral or of the Einstein-Helfand expression for the diffusivity in terms of a conserved current. Then in order to compute these transport coefficients from first principles, so the first thing to do is to find an expression for the current in terms of the microscopic information we have on the system. So in the case of the energy current, for instance, one has that the current, the energy current is given by the product of the atomic velocities times suitably defined atomic energies plus an expression that is a remnant of the virial of the classical virial, and that depends on these interatomic forces that are the derivative of the atomic energies with respect to atomic displacements. This is the expression that holds classically and that can be found in many classical papers and StatMech textbooks. Now, the problem is how to extend this to electronic theory-based approaches. So when you compute the dynamics of a system using the Schrödinger equation and doing, for instance, a Carpinello molecular dynamics, you don't have direct access to such quantities as the atomic energies, let alone their derivatives. And so the state of the art up to a few years back is summarized by this sentence, which says that the widely used green cubo relation, we have seen what it is, does not serve our purposes. So the purpose of computing the heat conductivity from first principles, because in first principles calculations, it is impossible to uniquely decompose the total energy into individual contributions from each atom. So how is it? How is it that a formally exact theory of the electronic ground state cannot predict all measurable adiabatic properties, including the heat conductivity? So in order to answer this question, let me make a step back from quantum mechanics and address the problem from the standpoint of classical mechanics. And we will see that actually the difficulty that was mentioned and highlighted before is not specific to quantum mechanics, but it is a difficulty that also holds classically. So basically, we have a number of definitions that we have already seen. We have a definition of the atomic energy, that is the kinetic energy plus the potential energy. The sum over all the atomic energies is the total energy, which is constant. And by doing some algebra, which I will not go through, we arrive at the expression that I already gave of the energy currents in terms of atomic energies and interatomic forces. So all of this seems very clear, very neat, and very well defined. Actually, it is not. Because if you take this expression, the obvious expression for the atomic energy, and you multiply it by, and you multiply this potential energy, that is the interaction between different atoms, time, you multiply this plus one plus any antisymmetric matrix. Here, the I and J are atomic indices. And this sum is the sum over all the distinct atomic pairs. Now you see that this interatomic energy, V of Ri minus Rj, is a symmetric matrix in the atomic indices. And if you contract the symmetric matrix with an anti-symmetric matrix, which I have put there just for the sake of finding an argument, of finding a handle onto the problem, then this sum of V times gamma vanishes because it is the contraction of a symmetric times an antisymmetric matrix. So that any choice of gamma would deliver the same total energy. So there is really no reason to favor gamma equal to zero, that is the usual obvious intuitive choice, over any other arbitrary choice of gamma. However, if you compute, if you go through all the algebra that leads from atomic energies to energy currents, then you will find out that the expression for the current depends on this arbitrary matrix gamma. So it seems as though the very foundation of the theory of heat transport is the theory stands on pillars that are ill-defined, because all of the theory stands on this local partition of the energy. This local partition is arbitrary, the current is arbitrary, and so it seems as though the transport coefficients are ill-defined, not only quantum mechanically, as it was feared, but even classically. Now, one possibility is to do some numerical experiment. You compute the time correlation function of this current corresponding to different choices of this arbitrary gamma matrix, and not surprisingly, you will find that the correlation functions depend on this arbitrary choice. You compute the Green Kubo integral, that is that integral that for large times deliver the transport coefficients, and you see that surprisingly, but after all, not so surprisingly, the large time limits of these integrals do not seem to depend on the matrix. So it seems that we are saved, right? So there is an intrinsic arbitrariness of the definition of the current, of the definition of the current correlators, so whose integral gives the transport coefficients. But in the end of the day, it seems that what matters, that is the integral up to infinity of this time correlation function, apparently does not depend on this arbitrary choice. So in order to understand why this is so, if this is an accident or some fundamental property of statistical mechanics, then we get a hint just by noticing that this arbitrary term in the current that is linear in this arbitrary matrix actually is a total time derivative of a vector that is bounded all over the phase space of the atomic phase space, so the space of atomic velocities and coordinates. So let us see what are the consequences of two currents being differing one from the other by a total time derivative. Well, what we have to do is to apply the Einstein-Helfand expression for the conductivity that says that the transport coefficient is basically the large time limit of the ratio between the variance of the integral of the current over time. And let us try to compute this variance and this lag time limit for the primed versus unprimed currents. So the primed integral is equal to the unprimed integral plus the difference of p of the primitive of this integral. And when you compute the variance, you have that the variance of d is proportional to time, because we know that the variance of d is proportional to time, and because the ratio of the variance of d over time is the conductivity we are after. But the variance of delta p does not depend on time, because p by construction is bounded in the phase space. So this is the variance of d is of order t. The variance of delta p is of order one, and by using a simple inequality of statistics that that is basically the triangular inequality for scalar products, we easily convince ourselves that this term is of order square root of t. So when you divide the variance of d prime by t, only these terms would vanish, this term would vanish, and only the variance of d would survive. And we conclude, therefore, that if two currents differ by total time derivative, then the conductivities that you can derive from them for them via the Green Kubo formula are the same. So let us see what is this, how general this conclusion is. So all we have seen that transport theory is the theory of the dynamics of conserved quantities. So of conserved and extensive quantities. We have that an extensive quantity is characterized by the fact that the quantity for a domain is equal to the sum of the quantities for any two of its subdomain. And this is the basic definition of extensivity. However, this definition neglects interface effects. It neglects the interaction between the two subsystems. So when it comes to partitioning an energy into energy of subsystems, so you have to decide more or less arbitrarily how to partition the interaction energy. And therefore, two different partitions of the energy would be equivalent if they differ by a quantity that scales as a surface term, a term that vanishes in the thermodynamic limit. So two definitions of the energy density are equivalent if their integral differ by a term that goes to zero in the thermodynamic limit, whose ratio with the volume goes to zero in the thermodynamic limit. So the difference of two equally legitimate energy densities should be the divergence of a bounded vector field. If we insert this expression into the continuity equation that that expresses energy conservation, we see that the current that correspond to the two different definitions of the density should differ by a position dependent bounded vector so a bounded vector field, the time derivative of a bounded vector field, so that their integral would differ by the total time derivative of a bounded vector. We arrive at the conclusion that any two conserved densities that differ by the divergence of a bounded vector field are physically equivalent, and the corresponding conserved fluxes differ by a total time derivative so that the transport coefficients coincide. So the solution to our first conundrum is that it is certainly true that the microscopic expression for the energy density is ill-defined, or the atomic energies is ill-defined. However, it is enough to choose any local representation of the energy that integrates to the correct value and to the correct total energy, and whose correlations decay at large distance. If you do so, the conductivity computed from the resulting current will be independent of the chosen representation. This solves the problem, and the program now is very clear. You just take any expression for the energy density in a density functional theory that integrates to the correct Kohn-Sham total energy. You do some painful algebra to derive the current, you compute the green cubo integral, and you get a conductivity that is independent of the specific representation. Here is an example of the conductivity of water. You have to focus on the zero frequency value of this function, that is the Fourier transform of the time correlation function. So the zero frequency Fourier transform is the time integral of the time correlation function. You see that given two different representations, one in terms of Kohn-Sham orbitals and the other in terms of a neural network representation of the Born-Oppenheimer potential energy surface, coincide in the small frequency limit, which confirms that transport coefficient is well defined. The value that one gets is not in very good agreement with experiment, but we believe that this is one manifestation, one of the many manifestations of the drawbacks of the PBE. These are PBE calculations of the PBE functional to describe hydrogen bonds and the dynamics, the structure and dynamics of liquid water. If we move to a scan and a DFT functional, we end up with a much improved agreement with experiment, and this is very preliminary. So I would skip this this part on lattice dynamics. Let me just say that this theory that is general for any state of matter, be it liquid, solid, crystal, or glassy, can be specialized to solids in the harmonic or quasi-harmonic approximation, allowing to bridge between different regimes of heat transport in solids that are described by the Boltzmann transport equation for crystals and the Allen-Feldman model for glasses, but I think this would take me too much time, and I would rather skip this and move straight to ionic transport. So ionic, if you have a ionic system with diffusing atoms, such as a ionic melt, or a liquid or solid electrolyte, the current is given by it's a standard definition, the product of the conductivity times the electric field, and the expression for the current is very clear. Classically, this is nothing but the sum of the products of the atomic charges times the atomic velocities. Once again, the conductivity is given by the product of the equilibrium value of the square magnitude of the current times the autocorrelation time of the current. So this is again a green cubo in a disguised form. If you move to a quantum mechanical representation of your ionic system, you would have that the system is described by a number of ionic cores that float into an electronic ocean, so that the positive charges are well defined classically, whereas you have a hard time defining defining the electronic contribution to the ionic charges. The rigorous solution of this problem is to express the current in terms of the time derivative of the total dipole of the system, so that you can express the current over with an expression that is similar to the classical one. However, the what classically was a static ionic charge, quantum mechanically becomes a dynamic quantity that is called the Born effective charge. The Born effective charge is the derivative of the total dipole with respect to ionic displacements. Mind that ionic charges are integer, constant, and time independent, and scalar, whereas effective charges are real tensor quantities, even non-symmetric tensor quantities, and they're time dependent. So you see that computing a current from density, a charge current from density functional theory is certainly well defined in terms of atomic charge of Born effective charges, but is by far non-trivial. Now, let me mention this other conundrum, this other mystery. So suppose you have an insulating liquid made of non-charged molecules, such as pure water. In pure water, the current is given by the aforementioned quantum mechanical expression that for sure does not vanish because the effective charges do not vanish. However, the conductivity rigorously vanish because pure water does not conduct electricity. So how is it that the non-vanishing conductivity comes from vanishing effective charges and vanishing currents? More generally, suppose you have dissociated water. Under pressure, high pressure and high temperature, the water partially dissociates. And this is a simulation where some people indicated there have computed the Born effective charges of oxygen and hydrogen in water. Hydrogen has spikes. The hydrogen effective charges have spike corresponding to the molecular dissociation. But other than this, this is the time series, a more or less stochastic random process of the time evolution of these effective charges. You can collect statistics of these charges. in the partially dissociated phase and in the superionic phase, you see that off diagonal matrix elements of these effective charge tensors are peaked around zero. The diagonal elements are peaked near what you would expect intuitively, near plus one for hydrogen and near minus one for oxygen, but not quite plus and minus one. So if you compute the conductivity using Green Cubo, you will find some time series, some expression for the correlation function corresponding to the current time series. And you can compute those in three different ways. Say, you do the real thing. The real thing is the quantum mechanical expression with time-dependent Born effective charges, this one. And then you can try constant charges. For instance, you can try the average effective charges, why not? And if you do the average effective charges, you get the wrong result. But if instead of the average effective charges, you take what a chemistry textbook would say, that is the oxidation states of hydrogen and oxygen, that is plus one for hydrogen and minus one for oxygen, you seem to obtain quite the current result, the correct result. So these authors noted that, interestingly, the use of predefined constant charges can yield the same conductivity as is found for the fully time-dependent charge tensors, but only if they have the values of plus one and minus two, which turn out to be the atomic oxidation states. How come? So let us go back to our Einstein-Helfand expression for the conductivity. Einstein-Helfand say that what you have to do in order to compute the conductivity is to compute the dipole accumulated by a molecular trajectory in a time t. You compute the square of the dipole, you divide by t, and then in the large time limit, this would give the conductivity. Here I have sketched a cartoon for a system in periodic boundary conditions. So you have a simulation cell that is this small. And of course, as the time goes by, your system will travel outside the first simulation cell and will diffuse up to infinity. Now, what you can observe is that the total dipole accumulated in traveling from A to B can be broken into two contributions. One is the dipole accumulated in going from A to A prime, where A prime is the periodic image of the initial condition. So this is just the same point translated by a few unit cells, plus the dipole accumulated from A prime to B. But the dipole accumulated from A prime to B is bounded because it all lies within a unit cell. And the size of the unit cell does not depend on time. The length of the trajectory, of course, depends on time, but the size of the unit cell does not. So you now see what you can play the usual game and say that the small dipole from A prime to B is of order one, so it does not contribute to the conductivity in the large time limit, and the mixed term, for the same reason as we saw for gauge invariance before, is of order square root of t. So that you can as well compute the conductivity, not from the dipole accumulated from A to B, but from the dipole accumulated from A to A prime. But then while the electronic Hamiltonian in B is certainly different from the electronic Hamiltonian in A, the electronic Hamiltonian in A prime, by definition, is the same as it is in A, because A prime is the periodic image of A. It is the same atomic configuration. And now the Thouless theorem on quantization of particle transport comes to the rescue in the sense that the fictitious trajectory from A prime in the parameter space can be seen as a cyclic Hamiltonian. So it's a Hamiltonian that is periodic in time. And if you have a time evolution of a Hamiltonian that always keep the electronic gap open, Thouless theorem says that the ratio of the dipole over the size of the cell has to be an integer. So you can express your conductivity in terms of integers, prompt our intuition towards topology, and let us see if we can express these integers in terms of topological invariance. So here we have a trajectory of a system that does not change unit cell, where the final configuration is in the same unit cell as the initial configuration. If you map this periodic repetition of unit cells on a torus, you see that the mapping of the trajectory on the torus does not have any windings. So the trajectory can be shrunk to a point continuously without cutting the torus. If you change unit cell, here you have a unit cell, you shift the unit cell by one in this direction and by one in this direction, and then you start accumulating winding numbers on the torus. And to cut the long story short, as the transported charge is a functional of the path, but the path has to be a continuous functional of the path, but the different paths that can be deformed one into another have the same winding numbers, so that the transported charge only depends on the winding numbers. So let us make an experiment. Here is a snapshot of a molecular dynamics trajectory of molten KCl, and one takes one particular potassium atom and one transports it across the cell, allowing the other atoms to adjust their position slightly in order to avoid each other and to minimize the instantaneous energy. And you get that the potassium atoms travels periodically the cell in one direction. If you compute the effective charges of the moving atoms, of course you have they will depend on position. But if you compute the accumulated charge, that is the ratio of the dipole over the size of the cell, you see that the diagonal elements nicely integrate to an integer, one, that is the oxidation states of the oxidation number of potassium, and the other diagonal elements vanish because a charge is only transported in this direction. If you move two atoms, now you have a positive ion moving along the z direction, a negative ion moving along the z and y direction. The z dipoles cancel each other because you have a positive potassium and a negative chlorine, whereas along the y direction, only the chlorine moves so that it accumulates a net charge of minus one. So to cut the long story short, we have that these transported charges are functionals of the path. The path is uniquely determined by oxidation numbers, and by using the associative property of this charge, because the charge corresponds, the dipole displaced along the concatenation of two paths must be the sum of the dipoles displaced along each path separately, then you can define the total charge as a linear function of linear as a linear integer function of integer arguments, and the coefficients give a rigorous definition of the oxidation states. So this is an example of the conductivity computed from the standard quantum mechanical definition of the current from the topological charges. We know that the two currents differ from each other, but the gauge invariance that I have tried to outline before show that the conductivity computed from these two different definitions of the charge should coincide, and in fact the slope of these two curves coincide. Let me move very briefly to non-stoichiometric melts. If you have the same system as before, molten KCl, but with an excess of potassium, what is known is that the excess potassium would release some free electrons that would localize into bipolar ionic pairs, so that the dynamics is of the polar ionic of the lone pair is much faster and uncorrelated with the dynamics of the ions. This is seen here. This is the superposition of several snapshots of the same molecular dynamics simulation. The green dots are the location of the Voynich centers of the lone pair, whereas the other pink and blue lines, are the trajectory traveled by cations and anions. You see that the lone pair, the green lone pair, travels much faster than the ions. You see in this case that there are two different possible trajectories, one in which the lone pair the excess electrons stays attached to the cation when the cation travels through the unit cell. And in this case, the cation actually would acquire an effective negative charge because it is plus one minus two attached localized electrons, so that it has an effective oxidation states or state of minus one. There are other trajectories, however, where the electron stays localized while the ion moves. It looks as though In this case, you can transport a charge without transporting mass. How is this possible? So all the Thouless machinery comes from the hypothesis that the electronic gap stays open throughout the trajectory. And here, if you have that the configuration space of the system, the gap is different from zero in all over the space when the system travels from one unit cell to another unit cell, the gap never closes, nor does it elsewhere in the configuration space, so that two distinct paths would displace the same dipole and the atomic oxidation states would be independent on the trajectory. If, however, there are regions in the configuration space where the gap closed, then the different paths joining the same points are no longer equivalent, and you can transport a different charge traveling along the blue trajectory than traveling along the green one. This is seen here. Here is a cartoon where you have three potassium atoms, this, this, and this, and one chlorine atoms with the electrons, the vanish centers of the electrons again depicted in green. You see that as they move back and forth, they exchange one electron. By exchanging an electron, they accumulate a net dipole without moving, without any mass drift. So in this case, you can again compute the conductivity in terms of these effective oxidation states, but in order to account for the position, the contribution of the lone pair, you have to count them separately. To summarize, when the gap never closes in a configuration space, one speaks of strongly adiabatic transport. Strong adiabaticity means that there are not only the gap never closes along a trajectory, but it does not close anywhere else in the configuration space. In this case, the dipole transported along a trajectory is independent of the trajectory, and you cannot have and the charge transport goes along with mass transport. Here in the cartoon, you can think of the dockers as ions and the boxes as charges. In order to move the charges, the boxes, so you have to move the ions, the dockers. But when you have regions in configuration space where the gap closes, then the transport mechanism is different. The different dockers pass the boxes one to the other, and you can have a charge transport without mass drift. So this is what I wanted to say. Let me summarize. Conserved currents are intrinsically ill-defined at the atomic scale. Conservation and extensiveness make transport coefficients independent of the specific microscopic representation of the conserved densities and currents. This gauge invariance of transport coefficients makes it possible to compute the thermal transport coefficients from DFT using equilibrium ab initio molecular dynamics and the green cubo formalism. This I haven't said anything. Topological quantization of charge transport allows one to give a rigorous definition of the atomic oxidation states. Gauge invariance and topological quantization of charge transport to make the electronic conductivity of stoichiometric ionic conductors depend on the formal oxidation numbers of ionic species via the Green Kubo formula without invoking any Born effective charges. And in non-stoichiometric conductors, the breach of the topological conditions that allow a univocal definition of the atomic oxidation numbers determine a regime where charge can flow without any associated mass drift. So let me conclude by acknowledging support by the Quantum Espresso Developers Group from the Quantum Espresso Foundation and the Max European Center of Excellence for supercomputing applications. And last but not least, my wonderful collaborators. Thank you very much for your attention.
Stefano, thanks a lot. I think I'll be the one clapping, but everyone is giving you a virtual clap. This was very, very beautiful and enlightening. So we'll go to a question time. So as mentioned, people are welcome to ask questions in the chat, or also we decided that people could ask questions live. So I will unmute a participant. Participant, as they prefer, they can write them in the question and answer, or they can just raise their hand. And I'll just give them the mic, and I have unmuted the first question from Raffaele Resta.
I'm online?
Yeah.
Hi, Stefano. Hi, Nicola. Nice to see you.
Ciao, Raffaele.
I've not read the preprint yet, but I have some question or observation on the last part about the non-stoichiometric. Basically, you have a stoichiometric mixture with two anion vacancies. And I understand that you love two because you have a single electron state. Otherwise, you should have a non-single state, of course. But in that case, it is known what happens. The anion vacancy generates a kind of cavity, and then the electron is trapped in the cavity. So you have an F center, and you have all of the atoms have the right oxidation number, plus there is essentially a vacuum region with an oxidation number of minus one. Now, when you have two, of course, you may have two of them together or two of them very far apart. And this is the problem similar to the hydrogen molecule. That is, if you take hydrogen molecule with a very long distance, you want a dissociation, the orbital picture is incorrect. You need the hydrogen-London wave function. And so density function cannot reproduce that. But in any case, it is clear that you have a closing of the gap, even in the hydrogen molecule in some sense, in order to switch from one wave function to the other. So any comment about this, or you agree?
Yeah, I mostly agree with some marginal differences. So I agree with you that there's a F-center picture of non-stoichiometric alkali halides is what is commonly accepted, and it is. I have some reservations, though, in the sense that if you examine closely the trajectories, you don't really see F centers. You see the electronic motion that is largely uncorrelated from the ionic one. And Jorge, you are right. This is very similar to the Grotius mechanism of proton transport in water, only that protons are replaced by electron pairs. And going back to the last part of Raffaele's comment, again, you are totally right. So the situation is similar to the hydrogen molecule, and it is exactly the closing of the gap when the two electrons get far apart that breaks the adiabaticity, what we call the strong adiabaticity. So there are regions in the configuration space where the electrons coalesce in bipolarons, and there the system is insulating if the concentration of extra cations is not too large. But when you dissociate the pair, you close the gap, and it is exactly that closure of the gap that determines these transport anomalies where charge can be transported without mass drift. Be aware, this is so even without breaking the molecule. So you don't have to observe a pair dissociation along a trajectory. Even though along a trajectory, the bipolaron stays bound, the very existence of those regions, of those metallic regions, of those regions where the gap closes, determines the fact that the dipole, the charge transported, depends on the trajectory, and that you can have a charge transport without mass transport.
Yes, I would like to add that you certainly have understood. You have understood that my idea of the F center comes from a famous electron in broth simulation by Carnevale.
Sì, lo so. Sure.
So my first question is: suppose you run a modern calculation within local spin density with an odd number of electrons, would you expect to find the F center even in the liquid, say something qualitatively similar to their calculation?
What I think, don't quote me, but what I think is even they do not observe any cavities. So this F-center picture is a literary way of describing things. So I don't think that there is a strong correlation between voids and electrons. So also because these electrons, be they unpaired or paired, are very delocalized. So the localization length of the electrons is larger than the typical interionic distance.
Stefano, I'll ask also a couple of questions from the question and answer panel so that we give awards to everyone. Then maybe I'll go back to one live question. I see Michele Cerriotti going back to the graphs at the beginning of your talk. He's asking if you can use the freedom of gamma to choosing a gauge that improves statistical convergence. That is, they all converge to the same value, but maybe some converge faster,
Absolutely. We do this all the time.
And how do you choose that?
You can, the question could be lengthy.
Okay.
You can minimize, so basically, let me try to say this in as quick a way as possible. Basically, what you can do is add to any current, any linear combination of currents whose diffusion coefficient vanishes. So let me try to. Do you see my screen?
We see the pictures, yeah. Now we see, yeah.
Okay. So suppose you have an expression for your current, call it J0. Then here, such that the integral of J0 of T, J0 of 0 dt is equal to some conductivity. Then you add to this any linear combination of currents that are not diffusive, so that the integral of ji dt of t ji of 0 is equal to 0. Then the conductivity, and this you call j of lambda. The conductivity of j of lambda is always the same. You have that.
Yep.
Now you can choose this. You can see the these conductivities in some abstract way. You can see them as scalar products in the space of currents. And what you do is you keep, by defining this scalar product, you subtract from a given current, the component over any other current that does not diffuse. I'm not sure I've been clear enough, but I would gladly discuss this with you when we meet afterwards. But the short answer is that yes, we can do that. And we do this all the time.
Thanks, Stefano. I'll take another question from the chat, and it's from Florian Knopp that asks about nuclear quantum effects, because it seems you could calculate these transport properties also, you know, as a, you know, from a ring polymer, basically, as an expectation value in a path integral formulation. Is this correct?
The short answer is that I don't know exactly how to do. And the reason is that you have to do, because these ring polymers are expression of the evolution of the system in imaginary time. Here you have to do real time correlation functions. And I think you can play with this centroid dynamics. And I think you can do that, but I don't know exactly how to. If your system is non-diffusive in the sense that atoms do not diffuse, and the quasi-harmonic approximation is a good one, then it is easy to derive an expression, a green cubo expression for the conductivity that holds quantum mechanically as well as classically. And this is the part of the talk that I have skipped. So the short answer is when the quasi-harmonic approximation is a good one, you can do this, and we do that all the time. When the quasi-harmonic approximation breaks down and the system melts or is near melting, then you have to combine real and imaginary time dynamics, which I know can be done, but which I have never done.
Thanks. I'll give the mic to two questions, deep dash first, and then Robert Molto. So we have two live questions, and then we'll see. Thanks, Deep, I think.
Yeah, hello.
Yes.
Am I audible?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Thanks, Stefano, for such a nice talk. My question is it possible that those bipolaronic system, can they make some cluster to club together and they transport through the system? And if this is so, will it be massless transport or with mass transport? Thanks.
Not sure. I got your question right, but I think that going from isolated electrons to these lone pairs, to these lone bipolarons costs a lot of electrostatic energy. You gain a little bit of kinetic energy because the one electron wave functions would delocalize a little bit. And above all, you gain some elastic energy for this F-center or F-center-like effect that Raffaele was mentioning before. But I think that bringing together more bipolarons would cost such a large electrostatic energy that they wouldn't be bound. So I don't know if this answer your question or if I got it wrong.
Hello? Just recently, a new paper I found where people report that there are short-range forces which bound these bipolaronic states. So those short-range forces are basically repulsive in nature. So that's why my curiosity is, like, if it has to be bound in some sort of chain, so there we have to overcome that short-range force. So where that extra force will come from? That's
the repulsive force. It may have a short-range component, but for sure it has a long-range one because
yes,
those bipolarons are charged. So the question is, what would keep them bound? And the only thing that would, in my understanding, would keep them bound is elastically mediated interaction that I'm afraid would be weak. But I don't know. I've not read this paper. I don't know.
Okay.
Thank you, Stefano. I'll give the word to Robert Molta, and then I think I'll ask a last question so that we keep this also. Robert.
Can Born-effective tensors be shown to reduce to atomic oxidation states in some sort of proper limiting condition, or no, because conserved currents are intrinsically ill-defined at the atomic scale?
My understanding is no. I have tried to play a little bit, but you know, there are. I have been thinking for a while that suitably defined averages of Born effective charges would would tend in some sense or the other to these oxidation states. But the final argument that convinced me, possibly wrongly, that this cannot be the case is when you have a solid. Take just a polar semiconductor. All the trajectories that are energetically accessible at low temperature have the ions stay very close to their equilibrium position, so that the effective charges would oscillate. So when would oscillate in time, but very close to their equilibrium values, so that the averages, the time average of the effective charges in such a polar semiconductor would be very close to the equilibrium values of the effective charges. Regardless of the value of the oxidation state. So the oxidation state of, say, chlorine potassium in a potassium chloride crystal are plus or minus one, but the effective charges are not plus or minus one.
I mean, are Born effective charges in any sense observable experimentally?
Well, observable in the sense that they give the infrared absorption strength. I don't know if they are directly observable, but the absorption cross section for infrared absorption cross section is proportional to the square of the effective charges.
Sure. I guess I'm trying to imply that if we cannot show that the atomic oxidation states are ever a limiting case, is that suggestive that the whole tensor at large, other than maybe in a trivial case, is not an observable?
I'm not sure, but even the oxidation states are not directly observable. Like, you cannot measure oxidation states. I transmitted the wrong message, I wish I had not transmitted. So all I wanted to say is that if you compute the current using atomic velocities and atomic oxidation states, what you get is a quantity, the current, that is not observable, but whose time correlation gives the correct transport coefficient.
Yes, sir.
The current defined through the effective charges, instead, I think that in principle is observable, in the sense that the current fluctuations is what gives noise in electronic circuits, and nobody would ever think of observing the time series of electronic noise. But if you were to, the correct expression that you should use, I think, is the one in terms of the effective charges.
Thank you for your time, sir.
Stefano, but to stay on this, and then I'll give the word to Raffaele Resta for the last question. I mean, a solid is not different from a liquid. So can you do something like you do in thermodynamic integration and drag the atom for which you want to understand the oxidation state around? So isn't there a way to really extend these concepts also to the solid state?
Absolutely. Actually, the extension was to the liquid state. The original thing was a beautiful paper by Andrew Rappe some 10 years back.
Okay, yeah, okay.
No, so they did exactly this. They did exactly this.
Okay, thanks, Stefano. So I'll give the word to Raffaele and then we'll close. Raffaele, I think I need to unmute you, yeah.
Okay, I would like to come back to the quantum nuclei. So just to point out that the Thouless theorem of quantization of charge transports is also valid with quantum nuclei. It can be proved very, very simply. Stefano knows how. So I would expect that all what has been done for independent electrons also holds for quantum nuclei, because quantum the basis of this work, of course, is the Thouless paper. But this can be generalized to the case where the nuclei are quantum. That's all I wanted to add.
Yeah, I probably agree with you, but I'm not sure that I would know how to use this extension.
Yeah, yeah, also, I would not know how really to do in practice, but in principle.
No, not only. The fact is, we use this Thouless trick to define some fictitious Hamiltonian, time-dependent Hamiltonian, where the time dependence of the electronic Hamiltonian comes from the moving ions. So the time dependence that we use is fictitious, and it is specifically associated to the classical ionic motion. I wouldn't know how to do anything similar if I were to allow the ions to behave quantum mechanically.
Thanks, Stefano, a lot. So this means there is still some work to do. The last word that's not yet said. Before thanking you, let me also mention that we'll keep with this online distinguished lecture. So we'll have Silvia Picozzi next month. We'll have Jens Norskov in January, Georg Kresse in February, Christine Persson, I think at the end of April. And also we'll announce all of this. We'll have classic in molecular and material simulations together with SECAM, where actually Rafael Resta and David Vanderbilt will talk about polarization, magnetization, and baryphases. I thought this was great. I'm very happy that Stefano accepted to be, you know, the first one, the guinea pig for this approach. But I think, as I said, it gives the opportunity to many to actually listen live. It's not the same thing as being in person, but I think it's you know, very precious in many different ways. So this.
Thank you for having me with you.
No, great pleasure. So this will be recorded, so you can also go back and tell your friends to listen. Thanks a lot, Stefano. Thanks a lot to Patrick Mayer for organizing this so beautifully.